Tag. That's about as much German as I've got, so hopefully I got this right. So my name is Jeremy Cox. I'm a, I'm a designer, director, animator, a whole bunch of things. And I use a lot of Cinema 4D, but so I'm based in New York, and if you've heard anime talks before or sort of know who I am, it may be through that I've worked at Imaginary Forces for the last 12 years, and that's actually no longer the case. I actually just left earlier this year, so it's a whole new stage of my life. So I'm kind of excited about that. It means I get a lot more flexibility in the kinds of projects I get to do, and I really get to spend time doing what I enjoy doing the most, which honestly I'm still figuring out exactly what that means, but so far I'm enjoying it. But given that I was, essentially I've been at Imaginary Forces for my entire career, I thought it'd be fun to put together a little montage of the work that I've done for the last 12 years. So I'll play that for you now. So I'm pretty software agnostic, I would say. Thank you. So a lot of that's Cinema 4D, but I kind of use everything. I shoot live action. It's a lot of 2D stuff. So I kind of just like to use whatever the best tool is at the moment for the job or whatever I'm learning at the moment, whatever I'm curious about. But a huge amount of that is Cinema 4D. And given that this is R20 was just released, and this is, I think, the 10th anniversary of the SuperMeet, I thought it'd be fun to actually go back and find the very first Cinema 4D project I ever worked on. And so I found it, and it was something I did in college. And I probably shouldn't say this, but I think it was a maybe not a legal version of the software at the time. But I'll play it for you right now. And I think it might have been R8.5 or so. And we were talking last night, and people were talking about being on the Amiga and things like that, and I can't compete with that. But for me, this is quite a while ago. So the assignment was to obviously make a logo animation. So I kind of had some fun with it and did this sort of globe fly around. Obviously, this is my first time ever using the software, so it was pretty crude by today's standards, SD, of course, as well at the time. But I don't know, I actually think it holds up surprisingly well, given that it was my first project. So I studied graphic design in college, and I was really interested in motion design, so there were a couple classes that I took. And fast forward a couple years, I ended up getting hired by Imaginary Forces, and I never really spent much time in 3D or in Cinema 4D in particular, but really I was focused on design and After Effects. That was kind of my specialty. So a lot of the early projects I did while I was at Imaginary Forces looked a lot like this. It was sort of really pushing After Effects to its limit. And so this is the opening titles to the movie Charlotte's Web, and we did this entirely in After Effects. So this is thousands of layers in After Effects split apart. And in retrospect, this is not the way to do this. It was a pretty masochistic sort of process to make something this complicated in After Effects. So going back, I would have done it differently. But I actually think that there's sort of a naive quality to it that I think actually comes through by doing the software, by using sort of a simpler piece of software like that. But anyway, so essentially at this point, I was using Cinema 4D for very minor elements and pieces. And so fast forward a couple years, This is the first project I really tackled that I would say like use Cinema 4D as kind of the backbone of the project. Like we started it in Cinema 4D, and the majority of the elements in the project actually were generated there. So this is the end title sequence for the third Mummy movie, and I forgive you if you didn't know there was a third Mummy movie, because I don't think anyone actually saw it, but it also wasn't very good. But it's actually based in China, and so the aesthetic was kind of based on this Chinese calligraphy and this Chinese artwork. So although it has a very sort of two-dimensional treatment to it, the entire sequence was pre-vised and animated in Cinema 4D, then with elements composited and anything. So again, I think by today's standard, it's pretty tame, but for me at the moment, this was actually a big revelation that we could actually kind of work this way, work in more of a 3D pipeline rather than being more of a 2D After Effects-based pipeline. So as I said, we really did create this in Cinema 4D and then sort of composited on top of that. So for example, that scene you just started here, this is the early previs we did of it, and you can see it's super crude, low res, but it got the idea across. And really helped the director and everyone get across the idea of, well, here's this kind of crazy fly-through camera we're going to do that revealed all of these scenes from the movie. And it really freed up our thinking on what the camera could do once we were working in true 3D rather than just the After Effects 2.5D working with planes. So having this real volume, suddenly we could do things we could just never do before. And again, me having kind of just, I'm kind of learning this as I'm going in Cinema 4D, so even things like this is one of the rock assets that you saw as we flew up the hill there. And every day I would be coming in and have no idea how to accomplish what I needed to do, but sort of figure it out as I went along. And I think that's one of the strengths of Cinema 4D is it's just so accessible for someone who's even barely used it. So in this case, I think I did Sketch and Tune that I then baked to the UVs of the object and then brought it into body paint and sort of painted on top of it to add in other little details, which to be honest, I don't think I could even do that today. I don't remember exactly how I did that. Or things like this. This is a scene we didn't get to when I just showed you, but you're actually kind of flying down this hill and go through a snowstorm, and then you actually see a Yeti at the end, which is a character from the movie. But you can actually see here like the number of passes that were running out of Cinema 4D, and this is before any kind of take system. And then I was even figuring out character animation at the time, which I think is kind of ambitious for a first sort of big Cinema 4D project. The other thing we're doing is, as I mentioned, there's a lot of compositing going on here, and we're still using After Effects at this point for compositing, but things like, as I mentioned, all these different render layers that we're splitting out manually without the take system to do. And then once we get down to the Yeti, this is actually all so like character animation, but then we're actually exporting nulls baked to the surface of the geometry that we're then parenting these paint strokes to, so they actually distort with the geometry. So again, I'm kind of impressed with myself that being so new at Cinema 4D, I was actually able to figure this out. So this brings me to sort of the main topic I'm going to talk about today, which is, I hope this sort of translates into German, but the idea of like falling down rabbit holes. And that comes from, the phrase comes from Alice in Wonderland, Lewis Carroll's novel, and obviously the Disney movie of sort of, in that case, it's literally being transported to a different world, but I think it's colloquially become, it's now known as sort of this like, it's kind of obsessions and distractions that keep you from doing what you're supposed to be doing. It's like you kind of fall down these holes of kind of explorations that may not have anything to do with what you're supposed to be doing, but they you find them interesting. So I'm kind of obsessed with these, and I've actually looked back at sort of, frankly, my whole life and found that I do this a lot, and I don't think it's actually as bad a thing as people make it out to be. Like I actually recommend, and you'll see by the end, I think that it's actually not a bad thing to be kind of become obsessive and become kind of interested in the minutiae of a project and not feel like you need to always keep the big picture in mind. So anyway, as I said, my whole life, I've been falling into them, and one of the early examples I could find was when I was growing up, I got really interested in catapults, and this was like summer vacation when I was in school at one point. I was building these tiny little trebuchets, and of course I needed to build a bigger one, so I sort of did a bunch of research and made an even bigger one. And then, well, that's not quite big enough, so let's, that's actually the same one. This one throws golf balls. And this is actually big enough, you could probably get hurt if you're in the wrong spot. But then, of course, I went even bigger. So this one could probably kill you if you're standing in the wrong spot. And I actually found a video, this is again probably 15 years ago or more, but I found a video of me setting it off. And so that's throwing a pretty big rock, about 100 meters or so. And so again, I think this is a pretty good example of something that has no practical purpose. It was just kind of an obsession that I had that I was really interested in doing. Like the neighbors weren't invading or anything. We had no real reason to be doing this, but it was fun. It was something that I got really interested in and just wanted to pursue to its logical conclusion. So that weirdly enough led to when R12 came out and they added the dynamic connectors in the dynamic system, what else would I test? But I built a trebuchet. So there are no, there's one keyframe that I'm using to release the sling, but other than that, it's entirely dynamics driven. And it's cloth bodies to, or cloth system to actually use the for the sling. So it's a little finicky, but it actually ended up working surprisingly well. I'm pretty proud that that actually actually throws that stone. All right, so that's an example of kind of a pointless rabbit hole that's just me exploring things. But I wanted to go down some of that are actually like client projects where we went off on these weird directions that we veered onto, but then somehow that kind of circles back into a final product that I think actually improves it. And the first one I want to talk about is, again, another sort of old project, but the movie Terminator Salvation we worked on and did all of the POV shots of the Terminators, all the machine vision where you're actually like seeing through their eyes. And this is like before Iron Man came out and some of these other movies that have really made like screen graphics like really popular and big these days. This is kind of us trying something new. So I'll show a montage of the work we did and then talk a little more about it. So for that, we were actually really influenced by like real-world technology, and that's really what we were researching at the time, was how computers actually see the world. And this was, again, about 10 years ago, so this was before sort of autonomous cars were a big thing, and so it's a little different today. But it's the same general idea that actually a machine seeing the world really needs to see the volume of the world. It needs to understand like what's in front of what and really see that depth. And so we ended up in that research coming across this sort of actual machine vision camera that would be used in factories and things to quality control things, and it's called the Bumblebee. And this was before the Kinect, before your iPhone could literally do this, but it's essentially a volumetric camera, a depth camera that can see the world through depth using these two stereo cameras. And although it was probably a poor financial decision, we actually bought one just as an R&D process. Again, just one of these sort of weird obsessions we had. So this is it in the conference room. I love how it actually looks kind of like a little robot with its eyes. It's kind of cute. This is it on my desk. And as you can see, there's software that you can just in real time see the volume of the scene in front of it. So here, obviously, you're seeing me. This actually, it became very inspiring, and one of the big things that we took away from it was that you think of machines as being precise, and there was an imprecision and a glitchiness and all these errors that popped up in these, especially once you see it. I know it's very dark, so hopefully you can kind of see it, but these are actual, like, there's a guy's face. So those imperfections really inspired us. We really wanted to push it so that you could feel like these were almost prototypes, like they were works in progress. They were figuring things out. They were getting better and better. So again, although we never actually used the camera for anything in the film, I think that some of these experiments and some of these tests really influenced a lot of the thinking into making the final. And so for the final, we actually used a lot of Trapcode form and After Effects to generate these point clouds. And at the time, the best thing we could come up with was to use just a depth mat rendered out of Cinema 4D to just use the black and white to just extrude the particles in space. And after we finished the project, I thought, well, there's got to be a better way to do this. I really want to have like a precise way to match a scene in 3D in After Effects in Trapcode form. And so that's where this came in. This is just a test I put together. But this mech model, I've got a shader that I've got applied to it, and you can see me just going through it real quickly. But so essentially, it's a gradient in X, Y, and Z that's RGB, and so it's similar to a normal point position pass that you may be used to, except that form, because it's After Effects, isn't floating point, so it's kind of a locked point position. But you can see you can take it in After Effects, and I made a little script that automates this. It actually makes an instance of form, and then you can see over there on the right, essentially it's just taking the color values of these gradients and mapping them into points in 3D space. It's just red equals X, Y equals, et cetera. So it's just using this coordinate system to make these pixels or these points in 3D space. And because it's because it's rendered out of After Effects with this sort of custom shader that I made, you can actually map it one-to-one with cameras that you can export from Cinema 4D. So here's an example that I made where the camera is actually exported from Cinema 4D, and then some of the assets and the renders around it are all Cinema 4D renders, but then the mech itself in the middle, that's all trap code form in After Effects. So it means you could take any scene of any complexity, render out these passes, and then throw it in After Effects, and you get a very light, easy to manage point cloud of it in After Effects that you could just fly around really easily. So again, I think this is one of these instances where it was just me taking it one step too far, probably, but it yielded things that ended up being very interesting and ended up being useful in the future. So everything I've talked about so far is kind of old projects. I think it's all been like maybe even 10 years or older. So what I wanted to show you next is actually one of the more recent things that I worked on. And actually the last project I worked on at Imaginary Forces before leaving was the title sequence to the Hulu show Castle Rock. And so Castle Rock is set in the world of Stephen King. It's a town that is in a lot of his books. And so we wanted to create a title sequence that really introduced you to the world of Castle Rock. And so I'll show it to you and then again talk about some of the process. Sorry, the screen's a little bit lifted, so it's hard to see some of the details in there. But so we literally tried to, it's almost like we were tearing pages out of his books, but then marking them up and adding all these sort of hidden details and connections and trying to essentially make it almost like there are these kind of conspiracy theories about the connections of all of his novels and this kind of like Stephen King universe. So we were trying to embrace that, and that really required being authentic and accurate to his books. And to be honest, I don't really read a lot of Stephen King, or it's not something that I'm particularly familiar with, but we got a lot of Stephen King books and read a lot of Stephen King. We had some people on the staff who did really know Stephen King, so it was a lot of consulting with other people, did a lot of research on the internet, and sort of really tried to dig into all of these details about like what are these Stephen King theories, what are all these details that we can put in here to really make it authentically connect to the Stephen King universe. So we did all that. We ultimately made the entire sequence in Cinema 4D and Octane, even though it was largely these kind of two-dimensional pieces of paper. We found that if we actually did it through a more physical lighting, we actually got a really nice tactile nature that we just weren't getting from the two dimensions in After Effects, the shadows crossing each other and just having that control over the texture of the paper. So I think we ended up with a really beautiful look for it that is much more atmospheric and, yeah, as I said, tactile than we would have gotten otherwise. And we ultimately exported nulls for all the pieces in After Effects and placed all of the content on the pages in After Effects, so we had a lot of freedom for revision so we could iterate as we wanted to change, as I said, all those details that we were putting in the pages. So we finished the title sequence. We thought, oh, that's great, we're done. And then the day after the show aired, things like this started popping up on the internet.
Hey, everybody. Ryan and Greg here. And we're here to break down the opening title sequence of Hulu's news.
Let me start that.
Hey, everybody.
Over with audio.
Ryan and Greg here. Hi. And we're here to break down the opening title sequence of Hulu's new series, Castle Rock. There's a lot of Easter eggs and references hidden in there that we found for you.
The title sequence opens on two pages from the book Needful Things by Stephen King.
It clearly circled the devil in Castle Rock. Also underlined Psalm 917. On the left side, you can see Castle Canyon Water District. This is just the work of a, you know, pretty clever title sequence designer.
This map of Maine is just full of reference. That the phrase Arrowhead is an allusion
the phrase,
to the
storm
secret
of the
military network
that crashed south of
Maine.
End
title sequence. Begin Castle Rock.
So this was one of these weird instances where, like, I like to think that we usually go into a lot of detail in our projects, and we usually like obsess over the little things, and usually no one ever notices, and it's one of those things that just adds to the overall thing, but no one ever actually, like, at least that we're aware of, kind of obsesses over it. And then this was something that we released, and literally the day after it aired, there were these 10-minute long videos, like going frame by frame through our piece and like circling things and literally like figuring out what every single little reference was. And I think it just goes to show that occasionally it is actually worthwhile to do that. And so it really reinforced that I think it's a good thing to go into that obsessive detail on projects, just because you never know when someone will actually like post a YouTube video that is pointing out every mistake that you might have possibly made. Which I don't think we made any big ones, but there's still maybe some that someone will discover in here. So that brings me to now that I've left imaginary forces, now I have some free time on my hands sometimes. So I've had kind of an interesting obsession, exploration that kind of inspired this whole thing recently. And although it's new, it actually kind of started in 2012, so about 6 years ago. I have this camera, this Pentax K1000 that I really love, and it's kind of sitting on my desk all the time. And I just love it as an object. I think it's really beautiful. But I wanted to get better at hard surface modeling. So I decided, well, this is a good opportunity to learn it, so I'll just start making this thing. So you can see here, just kind of blocking it in, getting some details. Of course, I'm obsessive, so well, let's put in all the details. Let's open it up and get all the details on the inside. Even more details. And back when I was doing this modeling, like this was essentially it. I think I ended up with a render like this that's not great. But essentially, that the exercise with creating the model, I wasn't looking to create a nice render or anything. It was just, let's make this model. And then fast forward 6 years to earlier this year, and I'd been using Substance Painter quite a bit for some projects, and I really loved just the process of texturing, and thought, well, I've got this camera model from years ago. Why don't I sort of resurrect that? And so the first stage, of course, was I didn't have UVs yet, so doing a proper UV mapping of it. What's a camera without a lens? So I figured, well, I might as well model a lens and put that on there. But I mean, what's a lens without optics? Like, you need to actually put optics in there somewhere. So I actually did a little research and found supposedly the sort of internal diagram of the specific lens I was making, like here what the optics look like. And I'll come back to that because I don't think they're quite right, but close enough for right now. So here I'm in Redshift, and you can see if I actually look through the lens itself, you're actually getting like what you'd expect. You're getting a flipped version of the image, which is what a lens would do. I needed to turn up the number of ray bounces in Redshift because by default it's way too low to see through that many layers of glass, and I'll come back to that as well. But you can see, like, I turn on the casing, and it looks pretty much like a lens would look like if you look through it. So at this point, I'm like, well, that's good enough. Okay, let's keep going with the model, and all right, it's looking good. Let's kick it out. Let's bring it into Substance Painter. So this is me starting to paint it. As I said, I really love Substance Painter, and we were talking last night. I actually feel like Substance Painter is kind of almost the what I wish body paint had become. It's such a procedural process of creating all this wear and detail. But I just love, again, because I have the physical camera in front of me, that's an old camera, so it had all these scratches and dings and things. So really trying to recreate all of that accurately, and the flaky texture of the metal itself and things like that. But I kept on looking at a perspective like this, and what I wanted was to look through that viewfinder and see what you would see out the real camera if you look through the viewfinder. And it seemed like a simple enough problem at first. Like, I know how a camera works. It's pretty straightforward. You know, you got a lens and the light comes in it. When you're looking through the viewfinder, the lens you're seeing, the mirror you're seeing right there is down, so it bounces the light up. It then hits this pentaprism here, which bounces around. Essentially, it corrects for the flipping that the lens does, and then it comes out the eyepiece, and that's what you're looking at. So, like, you know, how hard could that be? So the main thing I didn't really understand completely yet was the pentaprism, which is what this is. So it's a piece of glass that essentially has mirrored sides on it, which mean that when an image comes up through the bottom, it bounces around a bit and then comes out the other side flipped so that it actually looks like what you're seeing rather than a rotated version, which is what you get out of the lens itself. So as I said, like, looking at diagrams like this, I just couldn't wrap my head around like what all those arrows meant and what the light was actually doing when I saw that. So I created a little rig in Cinema 4D, and you can see my really basic camera there, and then I've got an image on the left, and I've got my mirror right there. But I'll just turn off the mirror real quick just to show you what happens just when you're taking a photo. So it's an X-particle system, so you'll see emitting particles that are representative of the rays of light. So you can see it flips the image upside down, or rotates 180 degrees more accurately, and then it would be recorded on the sensor right there. So that's kind of what a camera usually does when it's actually taking the photo. And the software can flip it, or the film, you can do it from the other side. So if I put the mirror in there, you can see it's bouncing it upwards. So again, that's pretty straightforward. It's easy enough. If I look at it from the top, it's now right side up, but it's flipped horizontally. So I need to figure out how to unflip that. And you actually see in some old cameras, the ones that you kind of look down like this to do, they actually are flipped, and that's actually what you'd see through the viewfinder. So the easiest thing to do is just put kind of another 45-degree mirror right here. So what this mirror will do is just bounce it right back out the viewfinder. So at least when you do this, it won't be corrected, but at least it's going out the viewfinder. So, and we actually got worse because we're now upside down and flipped horizontally, so rotated 180 degrees. So that was kind of a failure, which I knew was going to happen. But then, well, let's put a second mirror in there. Let's go from one mirror to two mirrors. Now, at least, it should be better because it's bouncing an extra time. So maybe we'll correct some of that. So here it comes. And well, now we're right side up, but it's flipped horizontally again. So we're the same as we were when we were looking from above, but that didn't quite get it. So this is where the pentaprism actually comes in, and specifically like the peaked roof of the pentaprism. So I'll turn on that right now and show you a little bit of how this actually flips the image. So if I hit play, it's going to bounce up. And then there's the interesting part. And I'll go back and I'll play it again. But you can see with the end, you get exactly the image that you put into it, which so I'll step through it. And you can see it's literally, it's almost like it's unfolding itself, or it's folding in on itself, which I, again, this is something that I just could not mentally picture without representing it in some three-dimensional way like this. So as much as I think it's a good demo for you guys to kind of show what's happening, I think for me, it was just me trying to understand what the hell I was doing. Because I think that's hugely important for me, is to actually understand kind of under the hood what it's doing, even if it doesn't matter if I understand how it's doing it, I kind of want to know why it's doing what it's doing. Okay, so with that, okay, we got a pentaprism. Let's put it in our camera. So here we go. It's the same setup as before. We've just got our camera and we've got a pentaprism in there. And okay, look at, we now got, we're looking through viewfinder, we see our teapot. You can see that the handle's on the right and the spout's on the left. And then you look through the viewfinder again, handle's on the right, spout's, okay, so we're getting the exact representation of the same image that we're seeing out the viewfinder. If I turn off the rest of the camera, you can see the pieces going on. So again, it's kind of the same thing we just talked about, but you can see the pentaprism on the top, and I'll turn that off. I've got the lens down here. And then I have the mirror, and if I look straight down at the mirror, you'll see essentially what we saw in that demo, where you see a flipped, horizontally flipped version of the teapot. And then if I turn the pentaprism back on, you'll see, again, what we just saw, which is the corrected version of the image reflecting through this whole system. So this would be nice if this was it, but unfortunately, I think we had about half an hour left in this presentation, so clearly it's not it. There's some other details I need to figure out here. And what you'll notice is if I actually rotate the camera around, we're actually getting a bit of parallax in the system. You can see how the teapot's actually getting closer to the edges of the lens. And that's not what you actually get when you look through the viewfinder of a camera. And that's actually because I'm missing a rather key component, which is there's an element that goes between that bottom mirror and the pentaprism there, and it's called a focusing screen. And what that does is it almost acts like this screen right here, where it's a diffuse material that's transparent that light is projected onto from the lens, but then you're just seeing, like you see this screen here, you're not seeing kind of the lens of the projector, you're seeing the light diffused through this object. So in this diagram I had before, you see that's the piece I kind of conveniently left out earlier, is this. And really all it is it's a piece of glass that has either been ground or frosted or anything like that just gives it this sort of matte quality. So it's still transparent, but it's a matte finish. And this was kind of where I knew I was running into problems, because in Redshift I'd already cranked the number of bounces all the way up as far as it would go just to get it to work in that previous demo. So I knew that adding even more elements in there just wasn't going to be something Redshift would be a fan of. So I asked around, and some people on the motion design Slack had suggested I check out the Indigo renderer. And as you can see from the examples here, they clearly like glass, and that's a good sign. They kind of sell it as almost more of a light simulator. It's like by default, if you just hit render, you get caustics, you get all of these things for free. Well, not free. It takes a long time to render, but essentially there are very few controls you get, which is exactly what I wanted. I just wanted light to behave like light behaves. So I bought a license and decided to play around with it, and rather than just go all in and just sort of take the scene I already had and just try putting that focus screen in there, I wanted to kind of take a step back. And I really wanted to sort of start as simple as I could and work my way towards that, really to understand the entire process. So this, as simple as you could go, would be like this, a pinhole camera. And rather than describe what it is, I actually, when I was a kid, I saw a PBS TV program that explained it pretty well, so I'm actually going to play that for you right now.
We've got the crime. We've got-
all you really need to know is they're kids who solve mysteries, and they get stuck in the back of a van by some bad guys, and they need to figure out where that van is going. So that's where I'll start it right here.
I can hardly see anything. We're jiggling too much. Feels like a little spot busted through. Why don't you let me go?
I have a better idea. If I can find a hunk of cardboard in all this junk.
Hear that? We must be near the airport.
What are you doing?
I'm making a pinhole camera.
A what?
Look.
It's upside down.
No kidding. The pinhole acts as a lens. The rays of light crisscross. It's as if we were inside a big camera box.
Looks like the airport, all right. Terrific!
So that's what I think about every time I think of a pinhole camera. But here's how I set it up in Cinema 4D. So I've got my scene on the right, which is just, again, a teapot, because that's what you use for these things. And then you can see my pinhole camera is a box with a tiny little hole in it. And then I'm putting my camera just inside the box. So you can see if I rotate around to the inside, you can see the nodal point of the lens is like just inside the box. So I'm looking at the back side of this box. As you can see there, the focal plane of the camera is on that box. So the plan is, what's supposed to happen is the light will come in, bounce off the object, come through that little hole, and then end up on the back side of that box, and we'll see it with our camera. Now, that's not exactly how a ray tracer, or in Indigo's case, a path tracer works, but I'll come back to that in a moment. So I hit render, and I think there's one little dot right there. I didn't realize this was kind of a successful render until later when I looked back on it, but at the time I just saw a big black frame, which is mostly what it is. After messing with some other settings, I finally got an image kind of like this, which I actually think is kind of beautiful. I think there's kind of an impressionistic kind of abstraction to it that I think is kind of cool, but that circle right there, that highlight that's on the teapot, that's actually what you were seeing with that one little dot on the side. So here again, just to show you how it's working, this is a render from the outside of my pinhole camera, and then if I do a little cutaway, you can actually see how you're seeing the projection of that scene out there from that little pinhole off into the backside of that box. And this is cheated a little bit. The exposure needed to get the image on the inside is so extremely different from the outside that, in fact, that would be completely white on the right side, but it's close enough for an example to kind of show how it's working. And so once I messed with things, like this is kind of the quality of render I was getting, which I actually think is kind of beautiful. I think there's like a nice, soft, painterly quality to it that I'm actually kind of a fan of. But it's obviously not an efficient way of rendering, but I kind of liked the accidents that I was getting along the way. So of course, I like to tinker with things. So this is me changing the size of the aperture, literally the hole that in that box. So you can see, as I change the size of this hole, and I'm also adjusting the exposure to compensate, because as the hole gets bigger, more light comes in. But as I do that, you can see you're just getting the entire scene more in and out of focus. And that's exactly what an aperture in a real lens does. It's just that here we have no lens, so it's just putting the whole scene blurrier or less blurrier. And you can see even because my aperture is literally just a square, that the bokeh itself is actually also representative of that shape, which I think is kind of cool. One thing I discovered here, though, is that render times were interesting. As you might expect with something like this. So the blurriest images to get something that looked like a real image was about 22 seconds, and then the sharpest that you saw earlier was about 12 minutes. So here's the difference. And you can see that in terms of noise, they're actually pretty similar. Like, they're both pretty grainy. They're not like super high quality images, but that's like super fast. That's over 10 minutes. So it's kind of the inverse of what you're used to when you're trying to render things out of focus. And traditionally, ray tracing, it's going to take longer to rectify a blurry image. But once you're dealing with the actual aperture and how that works in this kind of physical space that I've created, it's the inverse. A sharper image is actually way faster, or way slower, I should say, to rectify into a legible image. So that leads me to a little bit, again, just a kind of a tangent about ray tracing, or again, in this case, path tracing with Indigo. And so again, as you can probably tell, I like making little setups that kind of explain these things for my own purposes. So I want to show you that now, which is, again, I'm using X particles, but in this case, I'm using it to show how what ray tracing actually does is it shoots particles out of the camera, or I should say rays out of the camera, instead of what I described, which was rays from the light. So you can see here, I'm essentially just have an emitter that's shooting particles, and they're bouncing off the back wall in random directions because it's a diffuse surface. And the hope is that eventually one of these particles or rays is going to come out the box through that hole. But you can see how, because that's a relatively small hole, and in the grand scheme of my holes, that's actually a pretty big one, it's having a very hard time getting one that actually emerges out. So changing the number, I'm going to go from 1 per frame to 10 per frame. And you can see there, that's a lot more, but still nothing is coming out that hole. So let's go up even further. So if I go to 100 per frame, this should get us one. And you can see now it's actually even slowing down the viewport. Like, it can't handle this many. But there, finally, we got one that's emerging from that hole. And so that just sort of illustrates the challenge that the renderer is up against when it's trying to rectify an image when you're setting it up like this, which of course is a completely impractical, inefficient way of doing it. But for my purposes, it was what I was trying to do. I think it took about maybe 30, actually I think it was about 50 seconds for that one particle to be emitted. So that means that for one particle to actually emerge, it took 5,000 particles that missed. So again, it's an extremely small ratio. And as soon as they went even smaller with the hole, it goes even more astronomical in terms of the number of rays that need to get shot out for it to get one pixel or one little dot of information on that screen. So this is actually just from the manual of Indigo. And it just, again, really quickly, so normal path tracing, that's what I just described. MLT path tracing, that stands for Metropolis Light Transport. But I don't fully understand what it is, other than I think it looks for areas like reflections and refractions and knows that those are areas it needs to focus more rays on, which, as far I that kind of sounds like a biased render to me, although they assure everyone that it's an unbiased render, so maybe someone can explain to me later what the difference is there. But then bidirectional path tracing, that's kind of a combination of what I described earlier, where rays are actually coming from the light sources, like in the real world, but they are also coming from the camera, and then there's a sort of point of convergence where they're both found. And then the MLT path tracing is the combination of the two of them. But generally, for my purposes, for these tests, I found that MLT and MLT path tracing were by far the most efficient ways to do it. And if I was just doing normal path tracing, the renders would be hours and hours and hours, and then with this, it would be 5 or 10 minutes to get a decent render. All right, so let's get back to the actual interesting stuff. So here, you can see I've actually put a lens now, that lens I made earlier. I'm putting that in front of my box. So now, I'm putting these balls sort of in the distance, because what I want to do is actually measure the depth of field, because now that I have a lens, I should actually see sort of a focal point of it. You can see if I flip around, you can see that's what I'm seeing at my camera. You're seeing the scene. And then again, I have my camera pointing inwards at the back wall. I have it flipped upside down just so I'm not having to correct it later. It's just an easier thing to visualize. And then the other thing that's different is I have this plane here in the distance, or sort of partway through it. And this plane, I'm actually animating forward and back. And what I'm doing here is I'm emulating how a lens actually focuses. A lens focused by moving forward and back from the focal plane, or the image plane that's recording it. So by moving it, I'm essentially changing the point of focus. So once I render that, this is what I get. And you can see it actually is, it gets a little dark at times because the difference in distance is actually changing the brightness, but you can actually see you are getting a rack focus between the balls I put in space there. And then this is a similar test, but it's actually just changing, so the focal distance is the same, but I'm changing the aperture on the lens. So again, you'll see a few of these tests where I just love seeing what the difference in aperture does. One, you can see that the grain increases dramatically for the same reasons that we just talked about, but also you can see that there's a difference in depth of field. It goes from a very shallow depth of field to a very deep depth of field as the aperture changes. This was about the point that I realized that the lenses that I'd made were actually not very good. So this was partially just because I didn't understand what I was doing and just kind of copied those diagrams without really understanding how you make a real lens. And also, it was partially that the diagram I found I don't think was actually correct. But the first thing I did was, well, let's read a little bit about lenses and how lenses actually work. And surprise, surprise, it turns out that when you're talking about a spherical lens, they're literally spheres intersecting each other. So they're just different sizes of spheres, and they're either the point of intersection, or you can subtract them from each other, but that's literally what a lens is just these spheres kind of with different intersections. And there are different kinds of them, like these. So of course, now that you've probably figured out what's next, I built rigs to build myself all these different kinds of lenses. So you can see down there on the right, they're all controlled with user data that I can move around. But for now, I'm just going to delete all but one of them just so I can show you how one of these works. So I'm going to leave the meniscus lens, which is sort of a convex and a concave surface. And if I click on it, you can see there's all my user data. So that's how you sort of change all the parameters. If I go into it, you can see because, as I said, it's a spherical lens, so it's literally just two spheres with a bool and then a cylinder to sort of make the overall shape. So you can see there are the two spheres. And then they're all connected using just some espresso. And it's all actually really simple, even though espresso makes everything look complicated. And the only complicated part is I do have a sort of a spline preview that takes some more complicated math. And I'll show that in a moment. But really, it's just offsetting positions of these objects given this user data. So you can see if I drag the user data around, it's a little cumbersome to work with because bools are not the fastest thing to calculate. So actually on that bottom there, you might not be able to see it, but I have a detail multiplier that I'm putting to 0.5 that actually just takes all of the parametric objects and lowers the subdivisions of them. So see, now I can actually pretty interactively scrub around and change the values on these things. But if you want to go even faster, you can see there I have a spline preview. And this mimics all the same settings, but just using splines instead. And this is great if you want to go to a parametric view. So in this case, if I had a very specific lens I wanted to copy, I could just put that in the side view and then match it exactly as I wanted. So once I've got something that's working for me, obviously I can turn off the spline preview and then turn the subdivisions up again. And so the one issue I have here is if you zoom in really close, you'll see that just by the nature of bools in Cinema 4D, I'm getting some weird like Phong issues and some sort of ugly polygons there. But the one positive is that in lenses like this, generally the edges don't really matter that much. So it's really the surfaces themselves that matter, and you're getting these perfect spheres. These should be perfect spherical lenses. So of course, I took these into Indigo and did what Indigo does really well and spun a light around it and got some beautiful renders with all these accurate caustics and chromatic aberration and things like that. Another thing that I discovered sort of accidentally was that because these are completely parametric objects, I can take two versions of it. So I have a very thick version, a very thin version, and put them both in a cloner and then set it to blend. And that's how I'm getting all the three versions in between. So it's literally just a cloner with two options, and it's blending parametrically between them. So the other fun thing here is you can actually see that thick lens, see how close that image that's above is focusing? And then if you look at the thin lens, it takes it's almost at the very top before that focuses. So it's just these weird tests that I was doing just to try to understand how these things work. But of course, I'm also trying to make beautiful renders. So I'm doing things like this, just again doing what Indigo does really well, which is beautiful glass renders. Okay, so I figured out how to make lenses. It's kind of a tangent, but I still have the problem that my overall lens is still wrong. And how do I figure out how to fix that? So the first thing I did is actually take apart my lens, and I don't recommend doing this because especially newer lenses are not going to be easy to put back together, but this luckily was a pretty old lens that's relatively simple. But what I discovered from this was actually the diagram that I found was pretty accurate in all the pieces were right, and generally the shapes were right, and there were some inconsistencies I found when I measured things, but generally it was in the right ballpark, so there wasn't really that much reason to do this other than it was fun to take apart the lens. But really to solve it, what I did is I found this Java application, and this is the website, and this is what the website for every Java application looks like, I think. But so this application, it's literally sort of a 2D ray tracer where you can set up these lenses and just move them around and see how that changes the light and how the light moves through it. So what I did is I started just by recreating that diagram I originally found. So I'll load that in right now, and this is the diagram recreated as closely as I could make it. And that green thing that I'm moving around there, that's the distance that I, based on measuring, I found, well, this is how far it should be focusing on. And in fact, it's focusing way back there. So clearly there's something wrong in here that's meaning it's not converging on the right point. So what you can do is you can just kind of go in and change the values on these lenses and see how, well, that just changes sort of how these lines start converging. And that gets us closer, but you can see the issue here is, if I zoom in, They're not all crossing on the same point. There's this weird multiple crossing convergence issue. So what that actually means is that if I were to make this lens and put it in Cinema 4D, all the edges of the frame would be out of focus because the focal distance on the edge of the lenses is different than the middle of the lens. So again, this was like some of the things I was just discovering. But so here's actually a fixed version. So this is me just tinkering around until finally I figured out what magic sauce of, again, I don't really understand what all of this is doing. I'm just kind of hacking with it until it kind of works. So I'm doing all that, and then finally I get something that converges on the point that I like, and I think I got it working. So of course, I did another beautiful render of it. And then I got distracted again, and I decided to render some lens flares. And so this came about where I figured, well, I know that I can get an image to project on a surface through a lens. What happens if I put a really, really bright light outside it? Am I getting a lens flare? Just like in a real camera, you point a bright light, you get a lens flare. But my initial thought was, no, that's not going to work. That can't be that accurate. And then I hit render on it and got what looks like a lens flare out of it. This is adjusting, again, the aperture. So I'm not compensating for it in the Cinema 4D camera, so that's why it gets brighter and darker. But you can see the shape of it actually changes as the aperture changes. So it's one of those weird things that you don't really appreciate when you're trying to do like two-dimensional lens flares and compositing. But when you have this much control, you can really get a sense of what all these elements in the lens are doing to that lens flare. Another thing I did was, this is when the aperture is all the way open, so literally there's essentially no aperture. And I found that I was getting these crazy sort of chromatic hoops going around. And I just couldn't figure out what was causing that, because it was only when I essentially turned off the aperture, had it all the way open. And after doing some digging, I figured out that it was, again, those sort of imperfections because of my boules on the lenses. I was applying a subdivision surface to the lenses to get them just as smooth as I could possibly get it, to get it as perfect as I could. But you're actually getting pinching, and that's actually sort of rippling through the geometries. So you're actually getting these slight imperfections that kind of radiate from the edges, and that's what's actually giving it this kind of crazy like effect. And I actually kind of love that that's almost, that might be kind of accurate, just in that lenses may have little dings and imperfections in them, and that it's amazing how much those little things actually can multiply based on where they are in the lens. So of course, that made me want to go really crazy with this. This is a render where I just applied a displacer to the lens, and it's actually a pretty minor displacer, but you can see how it almost looks like underwater now. You get these real sort of caustic looking things from the lens flare. These are also, I should say, even those sort of grainy renders you saw earlier, those are probably like multiple hour renders per frame. So this is not an efficient way to render a lens flare, and I would not recommend you sort of try to implement this as I have it. But there might be sort of an OpenGL cheat way of doing it that I don't know about. But it'd be fun to create a real like lens flare simulation that is usable in production. All right, back to lenses. So I now have a correct lens that should be focusing at the right distance. So I should essentially have what I need. So this is mostly me just testing it out, and I'm putting like planes in there to see how the light's casting on the plane. Just trying things like turning off the aperture, turning off different light blockers to see what differences occur. I'm starting to put in like a fog in there just so I can actually see the volumetric light. Just turning things off again, like that's with and without the aperture. This is turning off the kind of blocker on the back part of the lens. So you actually get this really nice, you get like this really like swirly distortion there, I think is kind of cool. And I think that's just light kind of bouncing through all the edges of the lens that usually is blocked by the lens case itself. This is, again, me adjusting the aperture to see how that affects depth of field. You can see on the back, the second plane that's behind it, how in and out of focus that becomes as the aperture changes. And you can see the exposure on the right is changing because I'm compensating for the aperture change with exposure in my Cinema 4D camera. So technically, everything on the left is getting dark to like immensely bright, but I'm compensating for that in the camera. So you're getting the right side, which is sort of the real world, getting from dark to light. Just random tests, just moving things around to see what it does. Kind of like that one. This was kind of going back to the lens flare idea. So it's just a really bright light far away set on a just with some random motion to it. And again, because there's no casing around the lens, you get all these weird artifacts and things that I really liked. One thing I noticed is that I was getting a lot of imperfection in my reflections. And you can see this is the same frame rendered like 120 times in a row at really low sampling just to see what would happen. And it turned out that every frame was unique, which it shouldn't be. And I think that comes back to the as I said, the MLT mode in Indigo. And I think it's because it's randomly sampling every frame to figure out where the interesting points are. I think that it's finding different interesting points on every frame. But I have no evidence of that. I'm curious if someone can explain why this is happening, but I never found a solve for it. The one nice thing is I was able to average all of those frames together and come up with one really nice clean render. So that's the one nice thing that came from that. So you're probably asking, what about that focusing screen that I talked about probably 15 minutes ago that I kind of forgot about? So that was the whole reason we did this Indigo experiment. And here's my setup. This is my first try with a focus screen. You can see a very similar setup, lens, box. The one difference now is if I put it on wireframe, you can see my camera is now on the opposite side. So now it should be doing what I hope. And you can see if I click on that dividing, which is actually it's a cube that's very, very thin. But the material, it's a Indigo material that's essentially glass, but I have the roughness set all the way up. And so my thinking here is, well, that's kind of what the real thing is, so why not just try the real thing? And it can't possibly work. It can't be that simple. There must be something else that I need to do. But let's just render this and see what comes out of it. And I got that, which was exactly what I hoped would get, but was not expecting in a million years to actually get. So it turns out that was as simple as it was literally just putting a blurry, transparent material and putting a camera behind it. And again, I couldn't really believe it was that simple, so I put a camera in there, and this is, you can see it's just moving back and forth. And what I was looking for here was parallax, because if I was seeing parallax, it means I was actually seeing through the material to something else in the scene, not the projection on the plane itself. So this sort of told me, well, it's actually staying static. It's like I'm moving over an image, not like I'm looking through the plane at other objects in there. So that kind of taught me that, or showed me that I'm actually doing this correctly, even though I didn't think that was possible. Again, a focus test, just to see what, again, I'm just moving the plane back and forth. So let's put this all together. Like, we should have all the pieces we need now to accomplish my goal of putting a camera, a Cinema 4D camera, behind my real camera and seeing out the viewfinder of the lens. So here's the setup. Again, pretty straightforward. Here are all the important parts. So there's obviously the lens, there's a mirror, there's a focusing screen, and then there's the pentaprism. So all the things we just talked about. And then this is just a bunch of sort of, this is my, literally my picture view where I just kicked out every single render I did in the process. This is just me trying to calibrate it, trying to like figure everything out, trying to figure out, oh, this needs to move a little this way, my focus on the real camera needs to be, et cetera. So this is just me trying to troubleshoot. And then once I rendered it, I ended up with this, which was exactly what I had hoped to end up with at the end, which is kind of underwhelming, honestly, because it's like, it's one of those things where I spent all this time trying to accomplish it, and then I do it, and then kind of, well, what's next? Here's a just static camera in the viewfinder, and this is just moving the inner barrel of the lens forward and back. So essentially, it's moving the lens forward and back. And again, like I talked about, that's what focusing is. So you can see here how you're getting the actual depth of field racking between these objects. And this isn't Cinema 4D depth of field. This isn't something that's, or Indigo depth of field. This is the lenses that I have created actually generating that depth of field. The aperture in the Indigo camera is something astronomical. You can't turn it off. You can't like not have depth of field in Indigo because it's physically what it does, but you can set the aperture so astronomically small that it's essentially non-existent, and that's what I've done here. So all of this depth of field is through the lenses that I created. They're just slightly bigger, so you can actually see some. And it's still a pretty noisy render, and this is about 20 minutes a frame, so I'll say it again, this is not actually a realistic way of rendering things, and I would not recommend you try this for any production project for any reason. And then, of course, I just wanted to do some interesting renders with what I'd created. So this is, again, going back to my kind of like volumetric fog look to see what that looked like. Turning off the pentaprism so you can see how the focusing screen is kind of diffusing the light as it hits that ground glass. This one I haven't really figured out exactly what's happening in it, the sort of bullseye pattern you're getting. So I want to actually explore this more. This is literally the last render I did before I hopped on the plane to come here. But I think it's something about the sort of outside rings of the lens somehow refracting light in a way that you're then seeing as these rings. But again, it's something I can just put in some blocker geometry and things to see what's actually happening there. So this is probably what you're wondering right now. And that's the answer. But really, for me, it was just about personal exploration. It was about kind of learning the way these things work. And again, I don't think that I haven't yet created a final product that justifies like all that work that I put into it. But again, like I talked about at the beginning, it's this crazy process you go through can inspire things that you never would have come up with had you not gone through that crazy process to have gotten there. So I have no doubt that probably in the next couple of years, some project will come up that needs sort of some weird knowledge that I somehow gleam from this to do something interesting with it. Or I come up with an idea that I never would have come up with had I not gone through this process. And that's generally the way I approach everything I do, where there's no real wasted time. It's just sort of my own interests, and I'm either having fun doing it or somehow, somewhere down the line, something good will come of it. And so that's generally how I look at things. But we have a little bit of, well, we have 5 minutes left. So I actually have one more thing. So on a Slack channel, someone had asked about, I think they were colorblind, and they had asked about changing the interface in Cinema 4D to make it easier for them to see the differences between certain colors, and there wasn't a setting for it. So I dug around, and I found this image file that's a single image that has every single icon in Cinema 4D. And this was while I was trying to do all those lens tests, so even though that was kind of a random task that I had no reason doing, this was like a deviation from that, so it was like one step even further removed from what I was supposed to be doing. But I was like, well, that's kind of cool. I like that grid of icons, but why change one icon when you can change all the icons? So someone had posted a grid of emojis on the Slack, so I put that in there. And the moment I launched it in 7.4D, I kind of gasped a little bit. I think it was one of those like, oh no, what have I done? Like my heart kind of sank. Like what Pandora's box had I opened by doing this? And but I loved all the weird like the cone being the poop and the sphere being the like it, none of this was planned. Like it was all just arbitrary. Like this image just happened to have all these things in these places. And so I just loved the random or the undo being the praying. Like I don't know. I think that's perfect. The other thing I realized from doing this is how little I actually know of where things are without the icons. I actually tried to use it very briefly, just even to set up some like objects and things just to demo it, and I just had the hardest time trying to actually do even the simplest things when it's like this. So that being said, I highly recommend you try it, which you can do because I've put it all online. So if you go here, you can download the image files, and there's little instructions. There's even the old version, just in case you accidentally override it and you're stuck with emoji in your Cinema 4D, you can swap it back. But that being said, I take no responsibility for any harm you cause with this, or if you get stuck with emoji forever, that's not my fault. You brought this on yourself. So, Dankeschön, thank you. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you want to see what I do, that's my website, that's my Twitter. I'm generally hanging out on Twitter, so if you want to chat, I'm there. But I'm also here, so find me and let's chat. I'd love to talk. So thank you all very much.